Could it really be Earth? This planet with unrecognizable continents and northern hemisphere covered by a single vast ocean. Yes, it is indeed our planet. It is just the era that is different. We are in fact in the Devonian period, 400 million years ago. The six continents and two large oceans that we know so well did not exist yet. And the climate seems warmer than usual. In fact, there is no ice at the North Pole. And the Earth even rotates a little more slowly than it does today. Forests are few and far between in tropical regions and do not contain a great diversity of trees. A closer look, as if we were on the surface, confirms the sensation of being on a completely alien planet. The terrain is devoid of grass, and the trees, seen up close, are strange. There are no large trunks visible, but rather giant tree-like structures. Instead, there is a great variety of small plants such as shrubs and large clusters of moss. And if we look very carefully, we can see invertebrates, perhaps scorpions or large insects that move cautiously. It is a decidedly tranquil situation. In the water, however, it is a different story. Invertebrates are abundant, as are numerous species of fish. After all, the Devonian is known as the Age of Fishes, due to their evolutionary explosion during this period. But the fishes look strange, and very few resemble those we know today. On the shore of a muddy body of water, our eye catches a furtive movement. You'd swear we saw a fish scrambling to slide into the water. Is that possible? Perhaps, yes. And it is a great thrill to realize that what we have just seen is one of the first vertebrates, possibly a lungfish, venture onto land. Of course, it does not know it, but this tetrapod will lead to a great evolutionary transformation, giving rise to thousands of tetrapod species, including us, approximately 380 million years later. The Devonian is truly an alien world, a warm incubator of future worlds. So, what do you say? Shall we go and discover it up close? First, some background. The Devonian period occurred from 420 to 360 million years ago. It was the fourth period of the Paleozoic era. It was preceded by the Silurian period and followed by the Carboniferous. It is often known as the Age of Fishes, although significant events also happened in the evolution of plants, the first insects, and other animals. The supercontinent Gondwana occupied most of the southern hemisphere, although it began significant northerly drift during the Devonian period. Eventually, by the late Permian period, this drift would lead to a collision with the equatorial continent known as Euramerica, forming Pangaea. The mountain building of the Caledonian orogeny, a collision between Euramerica and the smaller northern continent of Siberia, continued to what would later be Great Britain, the Northern Appalachians, and the Nordic Mountains. Rapid erosion of these mountains contributed large amounts of sediment to lowlands and shallow ocean basins. Sea levels were high, with much of Western North America underwater. The climate of the continental interior regions was very warm during the Devonian period, and generally quite dry. The Devonian period was a time of extensive reef building in the shallow water that surrounded each continent and separated Gondwana from Euramerica. Reef ecosystems contained numerous brachiopods, still numerous trilobites, tabulate, and horn corals. Placoderms, armored fishes, underwent wide diversification and became the dominant marine predators. Placoderms had simple jaws but no true teeth. Instead, their mouths contained bony structures used to crush or shear prey. Cartilaginous fish, such as sharks and rays, were common by the late Devonian. Devonian strata also contains the first fossil ammonites. By the mid-Devonian, the fossil record shows evidence that two new groups of fish had true bones, teeth, swim bladders, and gills. The ray-finned fish were the ancestors of most modern fish. Like modern fish, their paired pelvic and pectoral fins were supported by several long thin bones, powered by muscles largely within the trunk. Lobe-finned fish were more common during the Devonian than the ray fins, but largely died out. The coelacanth and a few species of lungfish are the only lobe-finned fishes left today. Lobe-finned fishes had fleshy pectoral and pelvis fins articulating to the shoulder or pelvis by a single bone, humerus or femur, which was powered by muscles within the fin itself. Some species were capable of breathing air through spiracles in the skull. Lobe-finned fishes are the accepted ancestors of all tetrapods. Plants, which had begun colonizing the land during the Silurian period, continued to make evolutionary progress during the Devonian. Lycophytes, horsetails, and ferns grew to large sizes and formed Earth's first forests. By the end of the Devonian, progymnosperms such as Archaeopteryx were the first successful trees. Archaeopteryx could grow up to 30 meters tall with a trunk diameter of more than 1 meter. It had a softwood trunk similar to modern conifers that grew in sequential rings. It did not have true leaves, but the fern-like structures connected directly to the branches, lacking the stems of true leaves. There is evidence that they were deciduous, as the most common fossils are shed branches. Reproduction was by male and female spores that are accepted as being the precursor to seed-bearing plants. By the end of the Devonian period, the proliferation of plants increased the oxygen content of the atmosphere considerably, which was important for the development of terrestrial animals. At the same time, carbon dioxide, a greenhouse gas, was depleted from earlier levels. This may have contributed to the cooling climate and the extinction event at the end of the Devonian. Arthropod fossils are concurrent with the earliest plant fossils of the Silurian. Millipedes, centipedes, and arachnids continued to diversify during the Devonian period. The earliest known insect, Renilla precursor, was a flightless hexapod with antennae and a segmented body. Fossil Renilla are between 412 to 391 million years old. Early tetrapods probably evolved from lobe-finned fishes, able to use their muscular fins to take advantage of the predator-free and food-rich environment of the new wetland ecosystems. Things probably went like this. The subtropical climate of the period forced the fish to adapt even to the dry seasons when lakes would dry up and only small ponds remained. The fishes of them, like those of today, could breathe through their gills, which allowed them to extract the oxygen they needed to survive from the water. However, in the little remaining water, oxygen was quickly consumed while it was present in the surrounding air near the shore, where it was produced by the first terrestrial plants. To survive, a fish trapped in a small, dying pond had to not only breathe, but also keep its skin moist. It could therefore have only two options. The first was to bury itself in the mud by secreting a protective mucus and fall into a dormant state for the entire dry season. This is known as estivation, an evolutionary adaptation that affected the dipnoi, fish with rudimentary lungs, and continues in modern dipnoi. The other solution was to abandon the dying pond and move to a larger pool of water. By exploiting this new resource, a group of Crossopterygian fish, the so-called Ripodistia, learned to leave the dried-up pond and drag themselves on land, at least for the distance necessary to reach another larger pool of water. To do this, they started to breathe using their swim bladder as a lung, but excessive exposure to air could cause dangerous dehydration of the skin, and it was necessary to return to the water as soon as possible. Having muscular fins supported by a sturdy skeleton, three groups of fish, dipnoi, coelacanths, and ripidians, learned to drag themselves on mud and shores using their paired fins as rudimentary limbs. The lobed fins, like those of the Holoptochius, gradually became more muscular and supported by a sturdy skeleton in subsequent species, allowing the animal once out of the water to move by crawling. This was the beginning of a transition from fish to amphibians that lasted for millions of years. The amphibians, faced with an environment not yet exploited, soon became the undisputed rulers of the coastal, lacustrine, and marshy areas of the prehistoric world, with enormous possibilities for expansion and evolution. Even among marine fishes, paired fins underwent significant transformations to make the animal more agile in its movements in the water. In more primitive fish, the paired fins were relatively immobile triangular appendages, mainly used for body balance. Gradually, they became thinner, and the bones, called rays, fused together. two types of fins emerged, the ray-finned, still visible today in salmon and herring, and the lobe-finned, characteristic of bony fish. Interesting stuff. But we have to admit that, of that distant period, only placoderm fish enjoy a certain popularity among the modern public, impressed by illustrations, documentaries, and even many films featuring the most well-known placoderm of all, Dunkleosteus. A difficult name that few will recognize, but which actually identifies a sea monster now fixed within the collective imagination as the terror of the Devonian seas. Placoderms were one of the most successful groups in the Lower Paleozoic, particularly in the Devonian. The oldest date back to about 440 million years ago, and by the early Devonian, they were virtually everywhere, both in marine and freshwater or brackish environments. They reached their peak in the Middle Devonian, before disappearing at the end. For 50 million years, placoderms dominated the aquatic world, and it was only when they disappeared that sharks began to diversify, eventually becoming the great predators of the sea themselves. Most famous and terrifying species, Dunkleosteus terrelli, was the largest vertebrate ever to appear on Earth up to that time, and the biggest predator of its time, capable of reaching lengths between 6 to 9 meters and several tons in weight. The head and the initial part of the trunk were covered in a thick bony armor of plates, and its mouth, well, its mouth was a real horror show. It did not contain teeth, generally rare among placoderms, but sharp bony blades called dental plates. The two plates of the mandible, one on each side, sharpened by rubbing against the 8 smaller ones positioned on top along the jaw, which in turn became pointed and sharpened. In essence, Dunkleosteus was a hybrid between a tank and a bear trap. Biomechanical studies have determined that the bite force of a specimen about 6 meters long could be even more potent than that of a Tyrannosaurus or a Megalodon shark. Moreover, the mouth could open in a fraction of a second, creating a suction action similar to that employed on a smaller scale by many predatory fish even today. An authentic war machine that did not distinguish prey from sharks and other large fish, to even its own kind. Until, toward the end of the Devonian period, about 375 million years ago, a great extinction event shook the living world. It was the second mass extinction to hit the planet, after the one in the Ordovician period, 80 million years earlier. This time, it was not a single sudden event, but rather a series of smaller extinctions spread over a relatively short period of 2 to 4 million years. At that time, the colonization of land by land plants, invertebrates, and early tetrapods was still in its infancy. Those groups of animals already adapted to the land were less affected by the crisis, so much so that almost all of them survived into the next Carboniferous period, unscathed. Underwater life suffered the most, with the disappearance of ecosystems associated with coral reefs. These ecosystems would not return until 145 million years later, in the Triassic period. It is estimated that 75% of all fish families disappeared during the late Devonian extinction. Although freshwater fish were barely affected, marine animals were much more so. For example, placoderms, the terror of the Devonian, did not survive. Many brachiopods became extinct, the conodonts also disappeared, and only one family of trilobites survived. In total, more than 70% of the species that lived in the Devonian did not exist in the Carboniferous. A gradual depletion of oxygen in marine waters, global cooling, a drop in sea level, asteroid impacts. Many hypotheses have been proposed to explain the extinction. Recently, the hypothesis of a large hole in the ozone layer, or even the explosion of a supernova very close to the Earth, has been put forward, but the real cause is still completely unknown. All that is known is that from that moment on, sharks took over the oceans, and the colonization of the land had barely taken its first steps. Shortly thereafter, in the Carboniferous period, tetrapods would invade the world and begin the long journey through amphibians, reptiles, small mammals, and large reptiles, that would eventually lead to us.